In the last session, we made some understanding about the FPGAs, how it works, and how it is different from the microprocessors and microcontrollers. Now, in this session, we will talk about the FPGA design process, and we will also cover the important features which are needed during the whole process from designing your system to the FPGA integration of your system. So let's start. To program an FPGA, the most common method is to use a hardware description language, normally called as HDLs. HDLs are the programming languages specifically designed for describing the hardware behavior and structure of your digital circuits. With HDLs, you can directly specify the functionality of your hardware components such as registers and logical gates. But this is not only the option you have. Alternatively, you can use the higher-level languages like C or C++. However, this requires using a high-level synthesis tool to convert the code into a lower-level representation, which can be implemented on the FPGA. Some developers prefer the graphical methods, such as schematic editors or state machine editors, to design their FPGA projects. These tools allow you to visually create and connect the components with each other, which can be more easier approach for some users. Popular hardware description languages, HDLs, include VHDL and Verilog HDL. In this course, we will focus on VHDL. VHDL and Verilog HDL both are powerful languages that provides the full control over the FPGA designs. It is widely used among the FPGA engineers and students. Verilog HDL is weakly typed language, which means it allows you to write code that may not be valid. This can lead to the faster compilation of your designs, but in this case, the debugging will be more challenging during the testing and simulation process. However, VHDL takes a different approach compared to the Verilog HDL. VHDL is a strongly typed language. This means the compiler can identify the errors early in the development process, and this can save you a lot of debugging time later on. VHDL language is more deterministic, means its behavior is easier to predict, which make it more suitable for the safety critical applications such as in the medical field and aerospace fields, etc. However, VHDL requires more words to write to achieve the same results as compared to the Verilog HDL. Despite this, I will say that the VHDL is a valuable choice for the reliable FPGA programming because of lesser bugs and easy debugging. However, this does not mean that one is good and another is bad. VHDL and Verilog HDL both are powerful enough for FPGA designing. The purpose of the HDL languages like VHDL or Verilog HDL is to have the code which is synthesizable, which means the code which we write that should be translated into the hardware. This subset is generally referred to the RTL code, which is also said as register transfer label code. This RTL describes the hardware using the basic building blocks like registers and the logical gates, etc., and the interconnections between these elements. Behavioural code in VHDL describes the functionality of your digital system at the higher level, which has more focus on the behavior of your digital systems rather than its physical implementation details. The problem with the behavioural code is that it cannot be directly mapped to the hardware. Although this behavioral code is good for simulation to test the functionality of your digital system, hence we are needing the RTL code which describes the hardware components and their interconnections. And this can be mapped with the hardware elements in an FPGA or ASIC. Register transfer label or the RTL code describes a digital circuit which can tell that how the data moves between the registers. You can assume that RTL code is like the blueprint of your digital circuits, which uses registers and logical gates to describe that how the data will flow throughout the FPGA. To write the RTL code effectively, you need a solid understanding of your digital circuit which you are designing, including the logical operations and how the data flows between the registers. There is one important thing to note is that in the RTL code, you do not specify the delays directly. Instead, timing is described in terms of clock adds. RTL code is used as input for the VHDL synthesis tool, where it is converted into the netlist of the logical gates and flip-flops. We will write our RTL code later in this course. so it is okay if it seems complex at the moment. We will cover it later in details. Now, the behavioral code describes the high-level functionality of your digital system design, and it is primarily focused for the simulation. It cannot be directly synthesized and run on an FPGA. Hence, this type of code is often used to model the environment around your designs in simulation. Behavioral models are useful for the verification and can be compared against the RTL models to ensure the correctness. We will also explore that how to write the behavioral code later in this course. So it is okay if this concept is a little bit unclear at the moment. The FPGA design process involves the several steps that differ from the microcontroller designs. This is a typical FPGA design flow, which I am explaining here. However, if you are just trying to test some of your small VHDL code and integrate it into the FPGA for your test, you can skip some of the steps. Okay, coming back. So the process starts from understanding the high-level requirement of your digital system design, like what you are designing and what you wanted to achieve with your requirements. And then you will create some outline of your different ideas to achieve that requirements, right? Sometimes this looks simple, but maximum times when you're designing the complex system, then you will see them complex. Hence, you will need the requirement documentation or the specification sheets. And based on that, you can split the requirements into the multiple blocks and you will create some blueprints of those designs. Here, each FPGA block is a self-contained module that performs a specific task, like SPI or FIR filtering or anything else which is needed for your main requirement. Once the blueprint of your high-level design is ready, then you can start writing your VHDL code to describe each of your blocks. This process is typically done using the RTL code or register transfer label code, as you want this code to be synthesizable for the FPGA. Next, you would write the test benches to test each of your FPGA blocks which we have designed, usually using a combination of RTL and behavioral code. So, we test each block individually to ensure that they are functioning correctly. Because if you see any bugs in your design, then those issues can be fixed at the block level, which is just a small part of a big and complex requirement. Hence, it is easy to identify them and fix them. Instead, if you are just writing your code until your system level design is completed and then you start testing, then you will have the many untested blocks. So you can imagine the challenge to find the bug if your system do not behave as per your expectation. So remember this, that the splitting the complex design into the smaller blocks and individual testing of those blocks is a better approach to design the big and complex systems. Okay, coming back. So once we have tested all of our individual blocks and we are confident that all of our individual blocks and modules are working as expected, then now it's time to bring everything together. This is where we create our top level designs of the FPGA design. You can say it is our final assembly. To ensure the entire system functions as intended, we then write a comprehensive test bench that simulates the entire FPGA design as a whole, allowing us to identify and fix any bugs before we move on. And once we are confident in our design functionality throughout the simulation, then we can proceed with the next step, which is synthesis, where the HDL code gets translated into a format which FPGA can understand. You can say that synthesis is the bridge between your HDL code and the FPGA implementation. It takes your VHDL code and translates it into the netlist, which is detailed blueprint that specifies all the hardware components and how they are wired together. But the FPGA needs more than just a blueprint. It needs to know that how fast everything needs to work. That's where the timing constraint comes in. You provide the information like clock speeds and the delays caused by external connections. By taking these constraints into the account, the tool can try to create a layout that meets your design timing requirements. That ensures the data flows throughout the circuit at the right speed so that everything can function properly. After synthesis process, which creates the blueprint or netlist of your design, now it's time to translate that blueprint into the real hardware plan for the FPGA. This is where the implementation stage takes place. Here, you tell the tool exactly which pins of the FPGA will be used for external connections like clocks, data inputs, and outputs. The implementation stage then takes the netlist, timing constraint, and the pin information to perform these three tasks. Number one is placement, number two is routing, and number three is optimization. Let's understand them in brief. So first is placement, where system will figure out that where the each component of your netlist will be physically located into the FPGA chip. Then routing determines how these components will be interconnected using the FPGA internal wires. And finally, the optimization ensures the design is as efficient as possible. The end result of this implementation is a binary file, a special set of instructions that the FPGA can understand, which can be used to configure itself according to your FPGA designs. This binary file is like the master plan that tells the FPGA that how to perform the task. The implementation stage does not just translate your design, it also provides the valuable information and reports to you. Along with the binary file that configures the FPGA, this tool generates the reports detailing resource uses. This includes that how many resources are still available and how many input-output pins are used, etc. But the most critical report is the timing report. This report verifies if your design meets the speed requirement you specified earlier in the timing constraint. By checking this report, you can ensure that your design functions correctly on the real FPGA hardware. The timing report confirms that your designs can keep up with the speed demands of your project. This report is essential because even if your design seems to work during the initial testing, but failing to meet the timing constraints can lead to unpredictable behavior of your designs. Think of it that you have designed a machine and it does not meet the timing constraint requirements. Well, it might work most of the time, but they suddenly act differently, or maybe it can fail entirely at some unpredictable moments. These intermittent failures can be a nightmare to debug because they might only occur under some specific conditions, like extreme temperatures and something else. And in such cases, even reproducing the problem would be a challenge itself. For example, if you load your design onto the 100 of identical FPGAs, you might see that out of these 100 test FPGAs, your system is working perfectly fine on 95 devices, but they are not doing their jobs on rest of 5 FPGA devices. Then what? By carefully reviewing these timing reports during the implementation, you can catch these potential issues early, and you can ensure that your designs run smoothly and reliably on the FPGA hardwares. So that's the importance of analyzing the timing constraint of your designs. So in brief, these timing constraints are like the speed limits for your designs. If your designs violates them or fails the timing constraints, you may face the potential troubles later. The good news is that the FPGA tools can pinpoint those bottlenecks. They can identify the areas where your design can struggle to meet the speed requirements. Armed with this information, you can strategically rewrite your VHDL code to optimize its performance. By addressing the timing constraints and optimizing your code, you ensure that your designs run smoothly and reliably on the FPGA hardwares in the real world. Do not worry, the importance of timing constraints will be further explored when we will design our UART peripheral systems later in this course. For now, remember that the proper timing constraints and optimized code are essential for ensuring the reliable FPGA functionality. We will discuss about it deeper into the later sessions. After, the implementation stage equips you with the FPGA configuration file and the timing report. Now it's time to bring your design into the life. Unlike the macroprocessor that load the code from internal flash, most FPGA rely on the external flash only to store the configuration image. This is because that the most FPGAs do not have any inbuilt flash memory for storing the configuration image. Hence, this external flash memory acts like a storage bin for the FPGA memory. There are several ways to program this external memory. You can use a separate microcontrollers to write the image into the flash, or you can use a JTAG interface which can be used to program the external flash chip. We will explore these programming methods in more details later in this course. A simple schematic can display a typical method for storing the FPGA configuration images. Once the flash is programmed, then simply turn on your FPGA device and it will automatically load the image from the flash and initiate its operations. Now it's time to quickly summarize what we have learned in this session. This video provided a comprehensive overview of the FPGAs. We talked about the FPGA basic building blocks. We talked about the CLBs, configurable logical blocks. These CLBs are like the key elements of the FPGA. Combining the lookup tables for implementing the logical operations and the D-type flip-flops for storing the data like single bits. Many CLBs come together to form the FPGA fabric, along with the additional resources like embedding the memory and the input-output cells. We then explored the FPGA applications where their custom hardware capabilities shine. VHDL and Verilog HDL were introduced as the primarily programming languages for FPGAs. Finally, we have explained the FPGA design flow, guided you throughout the entire process, transforming your initial concept into the FPGA design, performing the simulation and test, ensuring your design meets the timing constraints, and ultimately generating the configuration image that brings your design to the life of the FPGA hardware. This knowledge equips you with a solid foundation of your future FPGA projects, which we will be covering in this series. In the next session, we will be talking about the signals and data types, so stay tuned for the updates. If you did not subscribe till now, then please do subscribe to learn and grow community for the regular updates. If this video is informative, then please like this video, comment on video, and don't forget to share. Thank you for watching.